Hope you guys are all doing well. Tonight, you guys are in for a treat because we have one amazing speaker all the way from Singapore that will come and share us the word. So be expectant, be attentive, and have a great time tonight.
Hi, good evening. My name is Roy. Now, I used to serve at FNL way back in 2013 and 2014, and I don't blame you if you don't know me because I probably don't know you, but during that time, I got to serve the youth together with numerous servant leaders like Pastor Fish, Pastor Ardo, Sarah, my homies Lev, Val, Wiki, and others. I used to hang out a bit more at the East where we played ball, you know, we went to KK on Saturdays and have a fruitful time generally at FNL. I occasionally went to the West too, so shout out to the Westies. I had fun doing things like the, you know, lock-in, and I love the youth there and the people that I was serving with. So when Pastor Swaggerfish asked me to do a short sharing, I didn't hesitate, though I do need to make a disclaimer. He and I had some miscommunication. I didn't know that I was going to be sharing to all of you. I thought I was just going to be sharing to the leaders who, you know, the devotions before FNL. I thought you still had that during this lockdown, during this remote video FNL that you're having currently. Pardon me if this setup is not what you're used to in terms of, you know, the standard of FNL production. This is just me in my house speaking truth using Zoom. So before I begin, I do want to talk about the inspiration, how I got this. Well, I've always thought that the best lessons to give are the lessons that I've already learned. So I learned this lesson as well as I was reading a book called Multiply by Francis Chan, and it led me to discover a little bit more about the Bible and to read up. And these are some of the things that I learned, and I hope that you will benefit. Before I get to the sharing proper, though, I do want to invite each one of you to pray with me, because I think this is an important time that we're going to be hearing the Word of God, and I think we need to approach it properly and ask God to help us understand. Oh, Lord, thank you for being our God. Thank you for being the Alpha and the Omega. Thank you, Lord God, for being the time creator. Thank you, Lord God, for taking care of us individually and yet taking care of the whole world. Lord, right now we know that the COVID-19 is going and spreading to a lot of other places and a lot of people are suffering, Lord. I do not know why this is happening, but I do know, Lord, that you are in control. You are letting things happen for a reason, and things that I do not know, I'm going to leave it back to you. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to trust you. And Lord, tonight, as we learn, as myself and my brothers and sisters who are watching are going to learn. Lord, may you guide our hearts, may you guide our minds, open up our lives, Lord. May we examine ourselves. May we come out of this sharing renewed and changed. Allow us, Lord God. May the Holy Spirit move amongst us and may conviction rise in our hearts. And all this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So, it being Zoom, so let me share my screen a little bit. Just pardon me as I look for the screen that I want to share. There you go. So, the last dance. I am a big basketball fan. I used to play a whole lot more, but now, you know, I'm not going to blame family. I just don't have the time for it, or I'm not making time for it. So, The Last Dance. So, how many of you have watched The Last Dance? For those people who don't know, The Last Dance is a documentary on Netflix or ESPN based on the last title of the Chicago Bulls way back in 1998. So I am of a certain age. I was already graduating elementary when the Bulls won that last title. Oops. Yeah, sorry, it's not really a spoiler. By now you would know that they won. Well, you know, me bringing up how old I was kind of tells you, you know, how far advanced I am in terms of age. So anyway, I am a big Bulls fan, so I have to watch The Last Dance. The protagonist or the main character in this story seemed to be Michael Jordan. Some people say it's biased towards him, but you know, we'll not get to that. Regardless of the narrative, I think it's very clear that he's the greatest basketball player ever. No cap. He's just the GOAT. The documentary is great, and it gives us insights on to how the Bulls work and how, you know, much one should emulate Jordan on the court, but probably not off it, because he was not the nicest person nor the most encouraging. One of the things that the documentary spoke about was MJ's comeback from retirement. So when he came back, because he won three championships before, and then he took a break, or he retired from basketball to go and play baseball for 2 years. And then he came back. He sent a fax and saying, "Oh, I'm back." So, you know, he had a comeback, and the documentary touched on that. And, you know, everyone I know loved that he came back from retirement, continued playing. He was like a breath of fresh air. You know, the documentary showed how everyone hung on MJ's word, and everybody was waiting on whether he would come back. And when he did, he was untouchable. Everybody was really clamoring to get to know him. Now, in the Bible, there were also instances of people making a comeback. So you have David after he had sinned. You know, he had Bathsheba's husband killed. He sinned and he made a comeback. You know, Moses, when he came back to Egypt after he ran away, after he killed the Egyptian, and then he ran away. Well, there's a lot of killing, huh? He ran away, and then he came back to Egypt after spending time in Midian and getting married and having kids, and you know, he came back to Egypt, and you know, the whole Prince of Egypt thing about let my people go. You know, I'm watching that with my little daughter right now, so do pardon me if I get into Moses mode once in a while. But tonight I want to talk about a comeback like no other, because this comeback is legit, and this comeback is life-changing, and this comeback is for real. This is Jesus' comeback. Now, before we talk about his comeback, I want us to imagine that we are one of the disciples. Imagine that, you know, before, you know, you're working your everyday job, when a mysterious teacher asks you, "Okay, come, follow me." And as you followed, you saw him challenge religious leaders, you saw him embrace sinners, you saw him heal the sick and even raise the dead. You knew that this man was no ordinary man. This Jesus was no ordinary Jesus. And at various times, and to varying degrees, people who saw him as the Messiah, and you yourself saw him as the Messiah who would bring salvation for God's people. You watch as the blind were given sight. You watch as he forgave hopelessly unrighteous people and restored lives of the broken. You know, you seem to be more aware of Jesus' identity as days pass by because you spend time with him, and then he died. And just like that, it seemed over. It seemed that Jesus could do anything, that he had power over sickness, over death, every person, everything. And then he passed away on the cross. Your hope of a better world died as Jesus was nailed to a Roman cross. And so you spent, as the disciples, like the disciples, you spent 3 days in confusion. You spent in disillusionment, and everything you had hoped for was gone. Then it happened. Jesus rose from the dead. He ain't there no more. He's not in a tomb no more. When Jesus reappeared on the third day, all your hope, all the disciples' hope came rushing back. Now there could be no doubt. Now that Jesus had conquered even sin and death, he would certainly fix this broken world, or so you felt. Jesus would accomplish what everybody was hoping to see, or so you felt. There could be no stopping him. You're thinking that he's going to carry on. He's going to do the trippy. He's going to disciple more people. He's going to preach, he's going to part ways, he's going to walk on waters. But he surprised everyone. Because unlike Michael Jordan, he didn't continue playing. Instead, he would telling the disciples that he would immediately transform the earth, Jesus gave his disciples a final commandment and ascended into heaven. His final commandment while he was on earth, before he ascended to heaven. And just like that, he went up to heaven. Of course, he did spend time here on earth. He spent a lot of time, 40 days here on earth. He appeared to many people, but many people had hoped that he would carry on and really restore God's people to their glory, but he had other plans. His comeback was something different. He didn't continue playing. Instead, he gave the disciples a command. What was it? Essentially, he told them that it was their job to finish what he started. It says in Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the ends of the age." I love that last part. We're going to touch on that last part. But before we do, I'm going to ask you about the Great Commission and you. If you're like me, there was a point in time in your life that, you know, you read these words and you thought, okay, so there are people that are going to be called as pastors and missionaries. You know, they're going to go on mission field. You guys go ahead, rock and roll. I'm going to give my time so that you can go. You guys go. But have you ever considered that Jesus' command was meant for you too? Now, the early church, which comprised the early believers, certainly thought so. They went about spreading the gospel to whoever would listen. They lived lives that were saved, that were full of love, and that jumped out of the norm. They didn't just stand out of the norm. They jumped out of the norm because of God's love in them. And people could not help but notice. And I truly believe that this Great Commission is not just for the early church. No, I want you to think about it a little bit. Do you think Jesus would just tell the early church, all right, guys, I want you to go all to all the world, go and baptize people, go and teach them, but in the year 2020, the rest can just chill? Nah. Inconceivable. I think the Great Commission is timeless. It's true back then and it's true right now. Now, you might be thinking, so what is discipleship? Now, the Great Commission, or what the, I'm going to, discipleship is disciple making. So what is disciple making? So the Great Commission uses three phrases to describe what disciple making requires. Go, baptize people, and teach them to obey everything Jesus commanded. Simple, right? It's incredibly simple in that you don't need a degree. You don't need to be good looking like Pastor Fish. You don't need to be a fabulous singer or a rock star like Wiki. Everybody can do it. You know, there's no ordination process. You don't have to be ordained. You don't have to go to certain schools or learn a certain number of memory verse. It's as simple as going to people, encourage them to follow Jesus. This is what this baptism is about. And then teaching them to obey Jesus' commands, which is found in the Bible. The concept itself is not very difficult. But sometimes it's the most simple things that we overcomplicate. So I'm gonna talk about this to few phrases in brief. So baptism was and is huge. It's an unmistakable act that marked a person as a follower of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm gonna leave Pastor Fish and the leaders to explain more about this in times to come. I know you guys probably know it, but for me, you know, as Jesus died and was buried in the earth, so a Christian is plunged beneath the surface of the water. And as Jesus emerged from the tomb, you know, symbolically, a Christian comes out of the water, but is as a new creation. Right? It's something that each one of us should really focus on. It's an important part of being a Christian. It's an outward expression of an inward decision. Now, the next one about teaching. Teaching requires studying and learning. And though you may not be an expert yet, unlike, you know, Pastor Fish, you're called to teach. What are you called to teach? You're called to teach whatever you've learned. You're supposed to cascade down. You're like a glass, and you just keep filling yourself with love, filling yourself up with knowledge and wisdom, and it carries out. You overflow to other people. It's learning does not stop. You're supposed to carry on learning till you can't learn no more. But so, you know, if you're worried that I don't have anything to teach, I don't have anything to say, well, you do know something. You do know something about God. Go and tell people about that. And then, since you don't know a lot of things, go and learn, go and study, go and ask somebody else to disciple you. It's all a process. If you want to be a disciple maker, be a disciple of somebody. Now, I just want to talk about that one word, two letters, go. And when you go, you have to take the first step. Being a disciple maker means that you will begin to look at the people in your life differently, people that God has placed in your life specifically. You're going to look at them differently because you know God and the people around you may not. And what was God, Jesus' command, Jesus' commission to you? Go. Now, take some time to consider what your first step toward disciple making is going to be. Whom has God placed in your life that you can teach to follow Jesus. Maybe God is laying someone on your heart you don't know very well. Your first step could be building a relationship with that person. Maybe it's someone you've known for years, and God is calling you to take that relationship to another level. God has placed you where you are, and the people around you are there not by accident. Keep in mind that the Great Commission calls us to every type of person, to those inside of the church as well as to those outside the church, to those who are like us and to those who are very different. Everyone needs to understand who Jesus is and what it means to follow him. Now, this may sound so daunting. You don't know things. You don't know what to do yet. You don't know how to start. And that is why I thought the last part of the Great Commission is my favorite part. As I close, I want us to focus on the last line. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Obedience to the Great Commission will lead to us seeing Jesus, seeing the Holy Spirit move through us, in us. We will see God move in wonderful ways in us. Because Jesus didn't just ask us to do it. He promised us that the Holy Spirit and the fact that he will be with us till the end of age. I want us to take that in. The Jesus who had power over sickness, the Jesus who made the ultimate comeback and defeated death and sin, the Jesus who had power over sickness and affliction and brokenness and sin and rejection. He had power over all of that. He will be with us as we disciple others. I don't know where you are right now, but I know there are people around us that we can go for. It could be as simple as starting a relationship with that person. You connect with that person. You show that person that you truly love that person. And then you disciple. Discipling means to just teach, to walk with that person. And I forgot to mention that I am a teacher. And the best way, one of the best way to teach somebody is to model it. So if you want to help somebody follow God, you want to help somebody follow Jesus. Does that make sense? Let me repeat that. If you want to help somebody follow Jesus, you follow Jesus and ask that person to follow Jesus with you. And I could go on and on about all this. And I didn't put it in my slides, but it just occurred to me as I'm speaking to you that the Great Commission is awesome and it's given to us, that it's timeless, and the promise is true that Jesus will still be with us. But brothers and sisters, my homies, if we are going to fulfill the Great Commission, if we are going to obey Jesus, let it be because we love him and because we love the people around us. Because according to 1 Corinthians, if you do not have any love, you're just a resounding gong. So at the center of the Great Commission is actually Jesus' love for each one of us. And so let that be the motivation on why you go. Let that be the motivation on why you encourage people to be baptized. Let that be the motivation on why you want to teach others. It's because you love God and you love the person that you're going to disciple. Let's pray. Oh Lord, thank you so much for your promises, which are true. Thank you so much for your love. Thank you, Lord, for always guiding us. Thank you. Thank you that you love us first, so we can love others. Thank you for the reminder to go, baptize, and teach. We will cling on to your promise that you're going to be with us as we go and obey. And we obey, let the reason behind our obedience be love. Allow us to love you and love others. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, that's it for me. I love you. Stay lovable. FNL. Bye.
How's that for the word of God? Thank you, Pastor Roy, for sharing it to us. We love you. We hope to see you guys soon. And for everyone else, we'll see you guys in a small group. Have a great time. I was running wild, fell in love with the chase. I've been up and down and all over the place, wasting all my days and nights, never feeling satisfied. Putting on a smile, I was keeping faith, but there's no imitating what I found in its grace. All the things I left behind, as shadows now I've seen the light. In my head and my soul, my heart, my all, I know that I know. Oh, never, never have I ever, ever thought of something so good. Never, never have I ever, ever gave over without you. Nothing can change it. All I can say is, you've got me looking forward, never turning my gaze. Forever, God, it's you and I, together till the end of time.